It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Michael Levin of Tufts University. Dr. Levin obtained two bachelor's degrees from Tufts in computer science and biology before he obtained his PhD in genetics at Harvard University, where his work centered around the molecular mechanisms governing left-right symmetry in the body. His lab focuses on the development of biochemical and optical methods to reprogram biological growth, with applications ranging from birth defect repair, organ repair, to the creation of synthetic living machines. I'll also note Dr. Levin is currently the Vannevar Bush, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, chair, and distinguished professor at Tufts University, where he also serves as the director of the Allen Discovery Center. And with that, thank you for joining us, and we look forward to your talk.
Well, thank you so much. Really appreciate the opportunity to be here and to share some ideas with you. I think this will be a bit of a wild ride. So hopefully you'll find it useful. So what I want to talk about today, and if you want to reach me afterwards with any questions or comments or get primary papers on all of the stuff that I'm going to show you, you can reach me here at these two websites. What I'm going to talk about is the idea of thinking about brains and what bioengineering can bring to the study of brains from a broader perspective. We're going to take a step back from kind of the obvious assumption of we think we know what brains are and what brains are and are not. So I want to think about this in a broader context. So the first thing, just to sort of start warming up with some unusual cases that you may or may not know about. The first thing I want to talk about is plasticity in the brain body system. So one thing that we've done some years back, and this is the work of Doug Blackiston in our group, is to create tadpoles that have no primary eyes in the head, but they do have an eye on their tail. And the interesting thing about these animals is that when you test them in a visual learning assay using this machine that we built, which basically asks them to learn to differentiate specific types of light cues and move around accordingly, they can see. These animals can see perfectly well out of these eyes. And so that's sort of remarkable, because for millions of years, this body design relied on having visual input from this area of the head to the visual tectum. And now when there's this weird patch of itchy tissue on your tail, you can somehow tell that this is visual data and incorporate it into your behavioral repertoire immediately without eons of evolutionary tinkering to get the connections right. Basically, many of these eyes synapse onto the spinal cord and so on. And so that already starts to introduce this notion of plasticity and the idea that this whole system isn't just hardwired to be what it is. It has a lot of flexibility in terms of getting functional outcomes from the situation that it's in. And let's take that one step further and look at what happens at in situations where you don't have a single static brain, which is what we're used to when we think about mammals. You know, you're an adult and you have a brain and that's that. Here's a caterpillar. This caterpillar is a kind of soft-bodied robot. You can think of it as it crawls and it chews leaves. And it needs to be transformed into a hard-bodied robot, which is going to fly and drink nectar. And in between that transition, it undergoes metamorphosis where the brain is largely liquefied. Most of the synapses are broken. Most of the cells die. And a new brain is formed that is appropriate to drive a completely different type of machine. The amazing thing is that memories persist through this process. So if you train and this is also happens to be the work of Doug Blackiston. If you train a caterpillar, then the moth or the butterfly that results from it remembers the original information, okay, on the behavioral in behavioral assays. And so the ability of memory to persist through radical reconstruction of the brain is very interesting, because first of all, it really asks a lot of our theories of how information is stored in the brain, because it has to survive complete remodeling of the substrate. And certainly we don't have any technology that's able to do that. And it also reminds us that bodies and brains can change drastically during the lifetime of the agent, not just at an evolutionary timescale. And if you want more information on this, there's a review here that you can take a look at. So the champion of this kind of thing are these planaria. And so These are flatworms. They are similar to our direct ancestors. They have a true brain with the same neurotransmitters that you and I have. They have central nerve cord. And the cool thing about planaria, which you'll hear more about momentarily, is that you can cut them into pieces and every piece will grow exactly what's needed, no more, no less, to be a perfect little worm. So they've got this sort of holographic storage of patterning information, and every piece will give rise to a complete worm. They are also immortal, they don't age. And so, and we can talk about that later. But the cool thing about, or one of many cool things about planaria, are that if you train a planarian, you can amputate its brain and it, you know, in fact, the whole head. The tail will sit there doing nothing for about a week. Then it will grow a new brain. And then once the head is complete, it will start to exhibit behavior. And it will then show you that it remembers the original training. So in this case, we see two things going on. We see that learning is able to imprint information across, apparently throughout the body, not just limited to the brain. And we see that that information can be imprinted back onto a new brain created from scratch from the stem cells in the planarian, and that information can be imprinted. So it's very interesting to look at and think about information traversing through the body, right? Traversing from one tissue into another tissue, back and forth to the brain. So in our group, we are interested in cognition across levels of scale. So we think about information processing and computation in everything from molecular networks, like gene regulatory networks, to cytoskeletal systems, to tissues and organs, and then of course, the whole organisms, whether through behavior or through morphogenesis and swarm cognition and so on. And so you can see here, this is a simple scale of all the different kinds of, from the very simplest passive behavior to all the way up to second order metacognition and all the different steps along the way of making cognition in different scales. So we want to ask a few questions today. What do brains actually do? How general are the things that they do? Do only brains do these things, or are brains just a special case? Where did they come from, and why does it matter? Okay, and these are the things I will talk about. So the main points of today, I know it's been a long day, so I like to bring out the main points early. Here's what I'm going to try to tell you. That first of all, brains evolved by speed optimizing ancient problem solving mechanisms and strategies that evolution first perfected in other spaces. Later it became for solving problems in three-dimensional behavior space, but originally this was for solving problems in metabolic, transcriptional, and anatomical spaces, and I'll show you what that means. And I'm going to introduce you to a concept of developmental bioelectricity, which illustrates the origin of neural networks as this ancient process, and points to a really interesting roadmap in regenerative medicine, including medicine of the brain itself. And I'm going to introduce the concept of anatomical homeostasis, which is a new model system for basal cognition. It's a non-neural kind of substrate that has goal-directed activity. It has intelligent problem solving. It even has representation and counterfactuals. And I'll show you examples. And we'll close by thinking a little bit about synthetic bioengineering and the fact that it now provides an astronomically large option space for new bodies and new minds that have an interesting relationship with evolution, because they are engineered and thus have no direct selection backstory that you can use to explain their capacities. So let's start off with anatomical homeostasis and the collective intelligence of groups of cells solving problems in morphospace. I want to first introduce this idea of intelligence as navigating arbitrary problem spaces. You know, we're all familiar with animals doing clever things to illustrate various degrees of intelligence in physical three-dimensional space. Okay, they're moving around in position, and here, you know, in two-dimensional space, the colors represent good and bad regions of space. So you navigate this space, and you know, life over here isn't very good, so you sort of figure out how to get around various obstacles, and now you're here. Okay, but the same thing, cells and tissues do the same thing in transcriptional space, which is a very high-dimensional space of gene activity. The same thing in morphospace, which is the space of possible anatomical configurations, right? You can think about all the different shapes of beaks of birds given by a couple of different variables that lay out a morphospace, and physiological space, which is again a complex space of lots of physiological parameters. And all systems need to navigate these kinds of spaces. And one example that has come out of our lab is that this is just an example of navigating physiological and transcriptional spaces, that if you take planaria and you put them in a solution of barium, the barium blocks all potassium channels, their heads explode, because without potassium flux, your cells don't do very well, their heads explode. But amazingly, within a few weeks, or a week or so, the planaria grow back a new head, and the new head is barium insensitive. So in other words, you leave them in the barium, and eventually they grow a new head that doesn't care at all about the barium. And when you ask transcriptionally what's different with these barium adapted heads to the normal heads, what you find is a very small number, just a handful of genes that were altered. Their transcription was altered to make them barium adapted. And so this is an incredible navigation of transcriptional and physiological space, because these tissues are hit with a stressor that they've never seen before. Barium doesn't occur in the wild. So it's not like there's some evolutionary preparation for this. And yet they figure out of this incredible combinatorial space of genes that they could turn on and off, they figure out a small number that is enough to solve their problem. And so how do they do that? We don't know, but it's an example of navigation of other spaces. And in general, your intelligence is your competency in navigating these spaces without getting stuck in local optima. So in behavioral space, it looks like this, right? The closest, if this animal wants to get to these animals, the closest line is here. And if you're just trying to minimize the distance, you're just going to stand there with your face pressed into the fence. But if you were smarter, you could walk around and really get to your goal, except that requires you to have some patience, because first you're going to move further away. So you have to get around this local optimum and have some tolerance for getting further from your goal in order to get to where you need to go. So depending on your intelligence, how you navigate these spaces. So I want to kind of generalize this idea of behavior problem solving and navigation beyond three-dimensional space. So now let's talk about anatomical morphospace. We all start life as a ball of cells. These are embryonic blastomeres. And then they create this. This is the cross section through a human torso. So this is, notice the incredible complexity of where all the different organs and tissues and structures, everything tends to end up in the correct size and position and orientation relative to each other. Where does that pattern come from? Well, you might think it's in the DNA, although we can now read genomes, and none of this is in the genome. You can't read any of this stuff directly from a genome. What's in the genome is protein sequences. And so the descriptions of the fine level hardware that every cell gets to play with. But what we still don't really know is how do cell groups decide what to make and when to stop? And in regenerative medicine, we ask, okay, if you're missing a piece of this, how do we convince the cells to grow it back? Okay. And as engineers, we want to know, well, what else is possible? Using these same cells, could we convince them to build something completely different? So now this is what an individual cell might look like. This is a lacrimaria. You can see this creature, it's hunting in its environment. Look at the incredible competency for goals at the single cell level. So all of its metabolic needs, its physiological, morphological, and behavioral goals are handled at the level of one cell. There's no brain, there's no nervous system, there's no cell-to-cell communication, there are no stem cells. One cell, this is real time, one cell is doing all of this, okay? And so the real puzzle then is, how and why do these cells get together to work towards much larger goals? And so you can see here this dynamic. You can see here this dynamic rescaling of goals, because in multicellular bodies, these types of these cells work together to do something like this. They, you know, here's a salamander arm. The salamander arm has been chopped off, and it will progressively regrow an exact salamander arm. So here, all the cells are cooperating towards this very large goal. No individual cell knows what a finger is or how many fingers you have or anything like that, but the collective does, and it stops when it's done. So multicellularity causes individual cells to cooperate towards very large scale goals, but then that expansion of goal space can actually shrink down again during the individual's lifetime, and that's known as cancer, because individual cells can in fact isolate electrically and physiologically isolate from the network that is working on this and basically roll back to a unicellular lifestyle and just act like an amoeba. And at that point, it just treats the rest of the animal as external environment. So this scale of goal-directed activity can shrink and grow. And so, and these are glioblastoma. These are happen to be human glioblastoma cells. And so this is what we see. We see that the single cell egg will eventually self-assemble into this these massively complex anatomical outcomes. And it's not just a stem cell biology problem because, you know, this is a teratoma. It has hair and skin and teeth and bone and muscle. But so the stem cell differentiation part went swimmingly here, but what's wrong is the three-dimensional organization. That's why this is a tumor and not an actual animal. And so in developmental biology, we are taught this, you know, sort of feed forward kind of system where gene regulatory networks turn each other, you know, genes turn each other on and off, and some of them make effector proteins that are sticky or they exert some force or they diffuse or whatever. And then all of this happens in parallel, and there's this magical process of emergence and out comes this complex this complex anatomy. And certainly it's true that many complex things are emergent in nature, but this feed-forward kind of system makes regenerative medicine difficult. Because if you want to make changes out here, but you're focused on this scheme, you have to ask yourself, well, what do I do at this level? What genes do I turn on and off to make specific changes out here? And that in general is very difficult. That's an inverse problem that's very hard. So what we are good at in molecular biology is getting this kind of data, right? Which genes and proteins affect which other genes and proteins. But what we really care about is where does anatomy come from? Why does your leg not look like your arm? What would you have to tell these cells? What kind of stimuli would you have to give them to make to fill in part of a complex structure like your ear that's missing? So in order to think about that, we note that there's flexibility, and which we already saw some of that in the first few slides I showed you. There's flexibility at every point. So embryogenesis is reliable, but it's not hardwired. So if you cut an early embryo in half, you don't get two half embryos. You get two perfectly normal monozygotic twins. If you have a newt and the newt makes a kidney tubule of this size, and here are the cells working together to do that, and you force the cells to be enormous by polyploidy, so you force these cells to have incorrect number of chromosomes, the cells get bigger and bigger. At some point, fewer and fewer cells will participate in making the exact same size lumen, and at some point, one single cell will wrap around itself and still give you the exact same lumen. So think about what this means. A large-scale anatomical goal, having this topology of this lumen of a certain size, can be implemented by diverse molecular mechanisms, either by cell-to-cell communication when the cells are the right size, or by cytoskeletal bending when the cells are huge. So multiple low-level molecular components can be activated in different contexts in service of a large-scale anatomical goal. Okay, flexible ways to get to the same point in anatomical morphospace space by using different paths at the level of the molecular details. Okay, and so this is the old limb regeneration phenomenon. These are axolotls. Axolotls regenerate their eyes, their jaws, their spinal cords, their limbs, their ovaries, portions of the brain and heart. And the amazing thing about regeneration, first of all, is that it works only to make exactly what's needed. So if you amputate at the shoulder, it starts here and it makes the whole limb. If you amputate at the elbow, it starts here and makes the whole limb. And then the most amazing thing about regeneration, which hardly anybody works on, is the fact that it stops. Everybody's working on trying to kickstart regeneration, but what we still don't know is why does it stop? And it stops when does it stop? When it has created the correct salamander arm. How does the system know what a correct salamander arm looks like, right? Because the steps it takes to go there are different. And in particular, we found some years ago that this plasticity is everywhere. Like if you take this is a normal tadpole here, and tadpoles to become frogs, they have to rearrange their face. So they have to move their jaws, their nostrils, their eyes. Here are the eyes. This is the brain. This is the nostrils. They have to move all that to be a frog. And it used to be thought that the genetics specifies a set of hardwired movements. After all tadpoles look the same and all frogs look the same. So if you just specify where you're going to go, then you get a frog. So we tested that by making what we call Picasso tadpoles. Everything's in the wrong place. The eyes are on the back of the head. The jaws are off to the side. Everything's moved around. And amazingly, those animals make pretty normal frogs because all the different organs move around through unnatural paths. And in fact, sometimes they double back and they overshoot and have to double back until they get to a correct frog face. So what the genetics actually gives you is a system that is able to execute error reduction, that it's able to minimize the delta between what's going on now, in this case, a total of mess, and what it knows is the correct pattern. So, and in fact, if we think about goal-directed behavior in various spaces, in this case, an anatomical morphospace, there's a couple of features that's important. It should be able to do that despite perturbations. And I just showed you we can do that with embryos. It should be able to do that from diverse starting positions. And you saw that because we can cut the leg at any position. And it should be able to do that via different paths. Here's an example. This is a frog that we've induced to regenerate its leg. So normally frogs don't do that, but we have a regenerative treatment that I'll show you in a minute that kickstarts this regenerative cascade and eventually makes a very nice frog leg. But what you can see is that the intermediate stages here look absolutely nothing like frog leg development. Frog legs develop as a paddle, and then there's a bunch of apoptosis that kills off the tissue between them. That's how you get toes. That's not how this regenerate works. It's almost like a meristem. It looks much more like a plant. It makes this central stalk with a toenail on the end, and then it makes the toes, and then eventually everything grows and you get a nice frog leg. So the ability to get to the same point via different paths through the space is a hallmark of goal-directed behavior. You know what your goal is, and you can deviate if you need to and still get there. So what we've been working on is this idea that anatomical homeostasis. But it's not simply a feed-forward product, a process that just creates a complex outcome. There are, in fact, feedback loops, both at the level of genetics and physics, that continue to try to get to this state despite perturbations. So injury, mutations, teratogens, whatever it may be, anything that deviates from this set point is going to activate processes that try to get you back there. Now, this the general loop is very familiar. It's what happens in your thermostat. It's what makes goal directedness not be magic. It's control theory or cybernetics. We have a mature theory of mechanisms that pursue goals like thermostats. But there's a couple of it, and of course feedback is not new for biologists. Everybody knows there's all kinds of feedback. But there's one thing that's interesting, which is that in this case the set point, what we call the target morphology, it's not a single number like pH or hunger level or something like that. It's a complex thing. It's a rough description of the large scale anatomy that you're trying to correct to. So that set point, and that kind of operation towards a particular goal is not something that molecular biologists and developmental biologists particularly love. People like emergence. They like chemistry. Working towards a goal sounds a little scary, even though it shouldn't. And so we wanted to test this, and it makes a very strong prediction. The prediction that this weird way of looking at things makes is that if it's true that this system in some way stores a representation of what the correct pattern is, and any homeostatic process has to do that, it has to store a set point somewhere, then we ought to be able to target that homeostatic set point. We ought to be able to rewrite this pattern memory. We have to find it first, then we have to decode it, then we have to learn to rewrite it. If we were able to be able to rewrite it, then we could ask the cells to build something completely different without having to rewire them. So the nice thing about thermostat-like circuits is that you can change the set point. You don't have to rewire your thermostat. You don't have to change anything about the structure of it. You just change the set point. And so that would be nice for regenerative medicine, because you wouldn't have to rewire genetically your cells. You could leave them alone and simply change the set point. So where is this set point? And this is what I want to talk about. Now, I want to point out simply that these cognitive-like properties of homeostasis, such as flexibility, robustness, goal-directed activity, and so on. Even the fathers of developmental biology, here's Hans Spemann saying over 100 years ago, that terms that people use in this process, which point to not only physical, but psychical, and it means psychological or cognitive analogies, was not just meant to be a poetical metaphor was actually informative, and in fact, Grossberg picked it up again in the 70s, talking about the relationship between memory and development. And all of this is actually very deep, and we've been working on this for some years now. So I want to show you how that happens. So this part of the talk is how these kinds of decisions of the goal directed activity of cellular agents, how it's actually implemented, the mechanisms, and basically what it is that in their own simple proto-cognitive way that body tissues think about. And you will not be shocked to discover that it's exactly the same mechanism that brains use. So in the brain, let's just get comfortable with the framework here. In the brain, you have the hardware, which is a network of neural cells, and then the electrical activity and the electrochemical downstream activity produces or enables a kind of software, which people who work on neural decoding and things like this, the commitment of neuroscience is that if we just understood the encoding, we could track the electrical activity and from that decode and extract the mental content. So we would know what the animal was thinking about, what memories were, what the preferences are, if we could extract the information in this electrical activity. And so what's key here is that this particular system uses the electrical activity to the output of this system is to trigger muscles to move the body through three-dimensional space. And this is how it solves problems by moving around, by issuing commands to muscles to move around in 3D space. And you can influence it by, yes, rewiring at the level of genetic change and surgery and so on, but you can also change its activities via experiences, neurotransmitter drugs, ion channel drugs, you know, and so on. So it turns out that here's the important point that all tissues in your body do this. So basically what I'm going to show you is that electrical networks in other tissues that are not brain and not neural, likewise drive physiological software, which among many other things, moves the body configuration through morphospace. The outputs of this system are not muscle motions that move you in 3D space, but reconfigurations of gene expression, of cell shape, cell proliferation, cell migration, and so on, that move your anatomical descriptor through anatomical space. And we're basically doing neuroscience outside the nervous system by asking, could we decode this? This happens to be a frog embryo, and you're looking at all the voltage-based communications between the cells. Could we decode this and learn to read and write this anatomical information? And so what I'm telling you is that much like in the brain where ion channels allow neurons to acquire voltage states and pass them on through electrical synapses to their neighbors, all cells do this. Every cell has ion channels. Most cells have gap junctions to their neighbors. And it's very likely that most of the cool tricks that brains do are basically speed optimized versions of things that tissues have been doing. Basically, evolution discovered this scheme around the time of bacterial biofilms. There's some beautiful work showing that even bacterial biofilms have very, very brain-like usage of electrical modalities to coordinate across distance, spread information, keep memories, and so on. So we developed some tools to, besides the voltage imaging that you just saw, we developed some functional tools. And it's very important to say that we do not use applied electric fields. There's no magnetics here. There's no electromagnetics. There are no waves or fields. We don't use electrodes. Everything here is molecular physiology. So we basically have just two main classes of intervention. We can change the topology of the tissue, meaning which cell electrically connects to which other cell, by opening and closing or mutating these gap junctions. And this is the equivalent of synaptic plasticity. Or we can go in and directly change the voltage state of individual cells, which by opening and closing various channels. And you can do this through optogenetics, through drug blockers, through mutation. And this is the equivalent of intrinsic plasticity. And so at the single cell level, one of the cool things you can do with this is in the field of cancer. So when we inject an oncogene, a human oncogene into a tadpole, they make this tumor. And even before the tumor becomes anatomically apparent, you can already see the aberrant bioelectrical signaling of these cells that are basically disconnected from the rest of the tissue. That's what oncogenes do. The first thing they do is disconnect the cell from its neighbors, and then they acquire an aberrant bioelectrical state that basically rolls them back towards an ancient amoeba-like single cell existence, at which point the rest of the body is just environment, and all it's going to do is make as many copies of itself and go wherever life is good. And so we've shown that you can interfere with this process by you inject your oncogene, but at the same time, you inject an ion channel that forces the cell into the correct bioelectric state with its neighbors. And there, even though the oncogene here is very strongly expressed, there's no tumor because the cells are now being forced to participate in normal morphogenesis instead of rolling back to a kind of ancient existence. And so even more importantly than this kind of single cell type of behavior, here's what happens in vivo. So this is an early frog embryo, and it's been stained with a voltage sensitive fluorescent dye that's showing us all of the different information processing events here. This is one frame taken from that movie. It happens to be grayscale, it doesn't matter. The colors are voltage states. And so you can see that even before the genes come on that are gonna pattern the face, all of the major features are already here in this electrical pre-pattern. Here's where the eye is gonna be, here's where the mouth is gonna be, the placodes. All of this is already here, as we call this the electric face. And if you make changes, for example, by mutating ion channels or using ion channel drugs, then you induce changes in the downstream gene expression and changes in the anatomy. This is what happens in a lot of human channelopathies where they have craniofacial and other types of defects precisely because of this. So this is an endogenous pattern that is required for normal morphogenesis. It is instructive for the formation of the face, because when you change it, the formation of the face is altered. So using these techniques, we said, okay, could we use this to write new information into the bioelectric computations that these tissues are using to undergo morphogenesis? And so you can do some interesting things. You could make five-legged frogs by asking the jaw to make a new limb. And this is an optogenetic frog line that we made. You can also do things like this. We'll take an ion channel, inject it into some cells that are going to be gut, and we'll induce an electrical state that electrical pattern that basically says build an eye here, and sure enough, the cells will build an eye. A couple of important things here. One is that you may have read in the developmental biology textbook that only cells in the anterior neurectoderm out here are competent to make eye. This is true if you stick with molecular inducers like PAX6 is supposed to be the master eye gene, then the only place it works is out here. But if you go upstream and address the sort of modular components that are encoded in these electrical networks, you can ask any piece of the animal to make an eye, including the tail and so on. That's one interesting thing. Another interesting thing is that this is extremely modular. So we didn't provide all the information needed to specify the structure of an eye. In fact, we have no idea how to specify the structure of an eye, and doing it by cell type and gene expression would take forever. It would be, I don't think that's going to happen in our lifetime. But what we did do was to find by treating the system as a computational system, which has modularity and plasticity, we identified a trigger of the eye making subroutine. The animal already knows how to make an eye. We don't need to know. We can provide a simple bioelectrical trigger that kickstarts that whole process. And this will be important in a minute. Also, as an interesting instructive aspect to this, where this is a lens sitting out in the flank of a tadpole somewhere, the blue cells marked with beta gal are the ones that we injected with a channel. These other cells here are wild type cells that we never altered. They were recruited by these cells to participate with them in making a normal, nice round lens. So these cells are able to get their neighbors to work together on this much larger structure. It's not just that these cells, we induced electrically cells to differentiate towards a lens lineage. That's not it at all. It's that we told the whole region to make a lens, and now everybody's going to participate within a certain radius, and it's not a single cell phenotype. one of the most advanced applications of this was here, where we actually used a computational platform that was created to make a model of brain damage. So here's what a normal Xenopus brain looks like: forebrain, midbrain, hindbrain. Here's one that's mutated, where the notch gene, right, very important neurogenesis gene, is mutated. The brain is a big bubble. Forebrain is gone. The midbrain and hindbrain are just a bubble. They have no behavior, no IQ. With the same thing you can do with nicotine, alcohol, various other teratogens. And what we've shown is that if you make a model of this process computationally in terms of what the bioelectric states are, you can ask the model questions like, if I wanted to get back to normal after a mutation or after I've been hit with nicotine or alcohol, what channels would I open and close to get me a nice sharp demarcation of a correct brain size and shape? And the model told us it happened to be the HCN2 channel. We used drug activators of HCN2, and of course before that, misexpression of HCN2. We tried that too, and it basically rescues the brain. Despite having a notch mutation, a very, very strong dominant notch mutation, you get normal brain shape back, you get normal brain gene expression, and you get their IQs back. These animals can learn again. And so this is important. The bioelectrics, the state of developmental bioelectricity is not simply that we can make changes and make weird monsters. The idea is that this is now to the point where we can make rational repairs to a very complex organ by understanding the dynamics of the electric circuits in the tissue, right? And we can use these models, these high resolution models, we can use them to predict drugs, basically, right? As electroceuticals. And this is another application of this, where we did this for the frog leg, coming up with a cocktail that induces leg regeneration. And this is where I have to do a disclosure, because David Kaplan and I are co-founders in a company called Morpheceuticals Inc., where we're trying this now in mice. So the idea is to go into mammals and try for leg regeneration in mammals. So this is there's a company involvement here. Okay. So one of the things that I really want to talk about is I promised you anatomical morphostasis as and a kind of this like homeostatic process as a new model system for basal cognition. So I've shown you goal directedness, and I've shown you modularity and flexibility and plasticity and robustness. Now I want to show you memory. So here's an example of memory. So here's our flatworm again. This is a one-headed flatworm, and this one-headed flatworm, not surprisingly, has anterior gene expression in the head and no anterior gene expression in the tail. Okay, and if I amputate the head and the tail, this middle fragment will give rise to a nice one-headed worm 100% of the time. Very, very stable, very reliable. Now, here's another worm, one head, one tail, anatomically normal. Anterior gene in the front, no anterior gene in the back, fine. I amputate this guy, head and tail, and now I get a two-headed worm. And this is not Photoshop. This is a real live two-headed worm. Now, why in the world would this animal give me a two-headed outcome? Because in the middle, what I did was I took this intact animal, and we induced two regions. So this is a bioelectrical map that you're looking from this voltage-sensitive dye, whereas a normal worm has one region of depolarization that says make one head. This animal, and it's kind of messy, right? The middle is all messy. The technology is still being perfected. But what we did here was we induced two areas of strong depolarization, equivalent, as we now know, because we've decoded it. It means make two heads. And sure enough, if you cut that animal, it makes two heads. Now, here's the really critical portion. This electrical map is not a map of this two-headed animal. This electrical map is a map of this one-headed animal. Meaning the electrical distribution is not a readout of what the anatomy is doing. And the same exact anatomy can hold on to one of two, probably a lot more, but we know for sure one of two different ideas of what a correct planarian is supposed to look like. So the anatomy and the bioelectric pattern do not need to match. The electricity is not a reflection of what the anatomy is doing. Conversely, it's a latent memory that sits there doing nothing until the animal gets injured. When the animal gets injured, the cells consult this map and see that we need to make two heads. And sure enough, they build two heads. So that's what I've tried to illustrate here, in that a single piece of hardware can hold one of two different memories, target morphologies that guide regeneration to a correct point. And when does it stop? It doesn't stop when it's made one head, it stops after it's made two heads, because the target morphology pattern is stored in the standing electrical pattern of the circuit, which can be rewritten. Okay, and so this is an example of a counterfactual memory. This animal has a memory of what it's going to do if it gets injured in the future. Not what it's doing right now, but what it's going to do in the future if it gets injured. And this, I think, is the basis of counterfactual kind of memory, like the very basement, you know, simple version of what later on in brains became really powerful technologies of imagining what you're going to do in the future, right? Thinking about things that are not happening right now. And the other reason I keep calling this a memory is because it is long-term stable. So if I take this two-headed worm and I cut off, if I make a two-headed worm and cut off the heads, this piece will continue to make two-headed animals in perpetuity, in plain water, no more manipulations of any kind forever. And then we can reset it back to one-headed. So this system is long-term stable. It's rewritable. It has latency or conditional recall, and it has discrete outcomes. This is all the hallmarks of memory. And here you can see these two-headed worms. This is what two-headed worms do in their spare time. Not only can we ask the system to make two heads, we can ask it to make heads belonging to other species. So if I take a planarian with a nice triangular head, I can cut off that head, prevent this remaining tissue from having the correct bioelectrical computations that lead it to the attractor in the morphospace space of a one head of a triangular head, and they can make flat heads. They can basically fall into the wrong attractor. They can make flat heads like this P. felina. They can make round heads like this S. mediterranea, or they can make their normal triangular heads. And this is not just for head shape. This is also for the brain shape. It makes the brain shape appropriate to these other species. Distribution of stem cells, same thing. Not only can we make heads appropriate to other species, remember, without any genetic change, both here and in the two-headed worms I showed you, the genome is wild type. There was no changes, there's no genomic editing, there's nothing wrong with the genome. This is all information that's stored in the electrical circuit. Where have we seen this before? Neuroscience, right? When you learn, you have a brain that can learn information that is distinct from the genetics of the physical structure, right? Can learn new things, not just what was in the genome. We can go further, and we can sample some attractors in the space that evolution doesn't use because they're not ecologically competitive. So we can make these spiky forms. We can make these cylindrical kinds of things that look like a hat. We can make this animal, which is sort of a flatworm, but then it's got this three-dimensional tube coming out of its back. Lots of things that wild-type cells are willing to build if the target morphology is rewritten to something else. So the summary of what I told you so far are that bodies are extremely plastic. They harness low-level various molecular pathways towards specific system-level outcomes, both in the anatomical space and what we haven't even had time to talk about, which is physiological space and transcription space. Like in the brain, this is in part mediated by a bioelectrical and neurotransmitter networks that store these pattern memories that are rewritable within the same in place hardware. And we can take advantage of a lot of tools and concepts from cognitive science. And if you're interested in this, we have a bunch of papers on this to target the decision-making by these cellular collective agents. And using those strategies, we reached all kinds of capabilities that were not possible before. And so the last piece of the talk that I want to talk about is synthetic engineering of shape. And Darwin famously had this line in his book when he was looking out into a riverbank or something, and he said, "There are endless forms most beautiful," and being impressed with a variety of living things. And I want to sort of jack that up to a new level. So I call it 2.0. And in order to think about that, let's go back and think about a fundamental knowledge gap. And that knowledge gap, broadly speaking, is where do the goals of collective intelligences come from? That is, if you have a swarm of robots, right? So a robotic swarm, or you have an ant colony, or you have a beehive, or something where the individual The individual agents are competent to do various things, but what's the collective going to do, right? What does the collective intelligence want? How do we guess? And in biology, this is very very clearly seen in morphogenesis, because here are a bunch of cells that know how to make a flat-headed planarian, and they stop when they achieve a flathead. This species has a bunch of stem cells that know how to make a round-headed planarian. And if I do this thought experiment, I'm going to say, well, I'm going to take this animal. I'm just going to mix the stem cells, right? Here are some red ones, here are some green ones. And then I'm going to wait till they get comfortable, and I'm going to cut off the head. What shape are they going to build? And despite lots of very nice papers in Science and Nature looking at the molecular pathways of stem cell differentiation in planaria, we don't have a single model of what head shape is going to result. None of those things address this in the slightest. Nothing that anybody's done in the field of stem cell biology and planaria can tell you what the head shape is going to be, because that is the answer to a completely different question. It's the question of, once we have a collective of these agents, these cells, what is their goal state? What are they going to build? Where in morphospace are they going to go? And understanding the molecular biology is important, but it doesn't go all the way to giving you this this answer. And so I think this is part of this much broader issue of, when you make things like the Internet of Things or swarm robotics, or even possibly social structures, understanding what that collective intelligence is going to do is, we don't have a science of that yet, really. And by the way, we are all collective intelligences. There is no such thing as an indivisible intelligent, you know, cognitive agent. We are all made of parts. So every single agent that you're looking at, whether it be an animal or something else, is a bag of cells. And we have to understand how they work together and where do the goals of the larger scale system come from. I mean, it's easiest to see this in chimeras, but it's actually true. In regular animals too. So what we try to do, and this is also Doug's work, what we try to do is to ask this simple question. Let's just start from scratch, and let's say, if we take some cells, we liberate them from their normal environment in the embryo, and we ask them to reboot their multicellularity. Do they like to cooperate? And if so, what are they going to make? So I'm going to show you is some experiments where we take skin cells off of a frog embryo. We do not genetically manipulate them in any way. We put them in a new environment and we ask what they do. Now, if I said I was going to do this, you could imagine, well, what are they going to do? Well, they could die. They could persist. They could crawl around. They could form a monolayer. These are the typical things that you might think cells would do. I say that ahead of time because it's kind of surprising what they do, and I want you to think ahead of time what all the other options are. This is what they actually do. So here are the dissociated skin cells being put in a little depression. They overnight, they sort of coalesce and they come together. They crawl around and they kind of get together. The fluorescence you see here is calcium signaling. It's pretty quiet at first, but then they start this very brain-like, very neural-like kind of thing. And remember, no neurons here, just skin. And what they do is they make this structure that has little hairs on the outside. It has cilia. And then something amazing happens. Within a couple of days, they start swimming around. Now, here's one of these things chugging its way along. And some of them, they can go in circles. They can go back and forth. You can see one patrolling back and forth here. Here is a tracking data on half a dozen of these things. You know, this one's going on a long journey. These two are interacting with each other. These two are sitting quietly. This one goes in circles. They have all kinds of behavior. I'm going to show you one that's in a maze. This is a still water maze. There are no gradients. There's no flow. There's nothing in here, just water. And here it is moving around. I'm gonna run it one more time. You can see what's amazing about this. So here it is starting. It's keeping a certain distance from the wall. Now it's gonna take this corner here without bumping into anything. So somehow it takes this corner, and then over here, it's for some internal reason that we have no idea about, it decides to turn around and go back where it came from. So it has this ability to interact with its environment, to know that it can take a corner, some sort of hydrodynamics or something that lets it do this without hitting the opposite wall. And then some internal change causes it to turn around and go back. So they have these, they're spontaneous. These are, we call them xenobots, because Xenopus laevis is the frog they come from, and they're a kind of biobot. There's no muscle here. There's no brain. There's no neurons. There's no external pacing. There's no external control whatsoever. Obviously, we really want to engineer these things in a million different ways, but the first few papers are focusing on their native plasticity because I specifically want to show off what can these things do on their own before we start to engineer them and before people say, well, now you've put in all these circuits and of course now they're doing things. This is bare bones baseline plasticity, okay? These little proto creatures. They also regenerate. So if you cut them in half, they will heal and they will close up right here. Take a look at the amazing, you know, when you cut them in half, look at that hinge, right? That hinge right there, 180 degrees. Think of the force that it takes to swing this whole thing around like that and get it to heal up back to its new xenobot shape. And if we track the calcium signaling, here it is. These cells are very active. Again, no neurons here, but you can actually see that they're quite active. And so there's even tiny ones that can form. Here's a much smaller one that's about 20 cells, and you can see here it looks like a little horse or dog or something, and they move as a group, and they have articulated pieces such as this, and then they interact with each other. That's a calcium signal, and so sometimes the way I give this talk is to show all this stuff, and I don't tell people what it is, and they say, what do you think this is? And they say, well, it's probably some kind of a animal you got off the bottom of a pond somewhere. And I say, well, we've sequenced the genome. And I say, well, the genome, that's great. Let's see what we can learn. And the genome, of course, is 100% Xenopus laevis. Okay, it's 100% frog. And one interesting thing about it is that these the behaviors and the morphology of these xenobots they don't have a straightforward evolutionary backstory, meaning they were not selected to do this. It was selected to sit quietly on the outside of a tadpole and keep out the pathogens and use the cilia to redistribute mucus and things like this. Within 48 hours in a novel environment, without eons of selection pressure for these properties, these cells put together a novel protoorganism with new structures and functions. And so that and we don't know if we're still starting to figure out, can they learn, what are their preferences? And we don't know how advanced they are without neurons. So it's really this novelty, this ability to come up with a functional architecture from scratch in 48 hours is incredibly interesting. And of course, one thing this helps us do is get beyond this very standard picture. This is a nice painting. This is Adam naming the animals in the Garden of Eden. So this idea is, look, we have standard species and we need to learn about them. And they have evolutionary pressure that explains why they have specific kinds of eyes and fur and they fly and whether, you know, all this stuff. And we need to get way beyond that. In fact, even pre-scientifically, people knew that you could start mixing and matching. So you could take a horse and a donkey at the genetic level, where they didn't know which genetic, but you could mate them and you get this weird thing like a mule. But we can actually do chimerism at all levels. So we can mix DNA, but we can also mix cells and organs, and in fact, whole organisms in parabiosis. We're making frogalotls, which are part frog and part axolotl. If you want an interesting puzzle, ask yourself if you think a frogalotl will have legs. Baby axolotls have legs. Frog embryos don't have legs. Will a frogalotl have legs? And why don't we know the answer to that, given that we have the frog genome and we have the axolotl genome? Why can we not use that information to tell what a frogalotl is going to do? And people have done things like put Drosophila neurons into rat brains, and they live for weeks and they cooperate with each other and so on. So the future is chimeric bioengineering, where every level of an organism, molecular, cellular, and so on, can be replaced with components that are either evolved or designed, you know, synthetic materials, smart materials, and so on, and be somewhere on this spectrum of either something very simple or something that has high level cognition and behavior, and they can be replaced anywhere. So there's this amazing capacity to make new types of living agents, which are which have never been seen before, which don't have a position on the phylogenetic tree, which, and some of this is already here, you know, cyborgs and hybrids and humans with brain and other organ implants and mice linked together in groups where their brains are linked together in groups and so on. And you if you're interested in this kind of stuff, take a look. We have a paper here where we point out that, Josh Bongard and I point out that these kind of terms, machine, animal, robot, synthetic, evolved design, all of these things were pretty good categories 20 to 30 years ago. They're not good categories anymore. There are many reasons why these things no longer really pick out anything, sharp, and we can talk about that. And so there are going to be, we are going, in our lifetimes, we are going to see a massive explosion of unconventional agents that are partly software, partly hardware, and they're going to be, and in different kinds of biological and designed and evolved components that are all going to be somewhere along this continuum, okay? And what we're not going to be able to do is to guess where they are by looking at what they're made of and where they came from. It used to be that you could look at something and you knock on it, and if you hear a clanging sound, you say, "Aha, that's designed, and it's non-living, and it's probably not very smart, and you can take it apart, and it's fine, and there's no ethical issues." And if it was soft and furry and sort of squishy, then you would say, "Yeah, that's probably biological, and it might have some degree of intelligence because I see a backbone and a brain." And then you have to treat it more, with some care. We are going to see something like this. All of that, everything we know from the phylogeny on Earth is going to be here in this like tiny little corner of this huge space of all of the possible combinations of evolved material from the living world, designed material and machines, and software agents. And this is going to be massive. So the conclusions from everything, so I'm just going to stop here, are these. That morphogenesis is just one example of this kind of protocognitive process, and it has a lot to teach us about intelligence and the scaling of cognition and where brains and behavior came from. Bioelectrical networks, they store and process a kind of pattern memory that controls this journey through anatomical morphospace. And we have lots of interesting ideas about using tissue training and so on to achieve regenerative medicine goals, as opposed to micromanaging the hardware of cells, so rewiring pathways and things like that. And synthetic morphology and these various chimeric techniques, and so bioengineering, not only reveals the plasticity of life that is really very poorly understood still, and we have huge gaps in our knowledge of the mapping between DNA and anatomy and where evolutionary novelty comes from and so on, but they also provide a very rich new space for the creation of novel, diverse minds, whether with brains or without, or different kinds of brains that you've never seen before, which have to be dealt with any new theory of cognition. In fact, we have this continuum of bodies and minds that completely breaks the current distinctions of what a machine is, what an organism is, what a robot is. We have machines that are evolved now. We have designed organisms and so on. All of this requires us to identify the essential concepts, not those that are based on contingent things like where did something come from or the various frozen accidents of evolution, and really understand what we mean by a robot or an organism and so on. And I'll just close by saying that this has massive implications for ethics, because I don't think the kind of thing that we do in a lot of bioengineering meetings, where we spend time worried about how much like a human brain is some sort of construct or organoid, right? As far as the ethics of it, we have to go much beyond that. We have to think about the ethics of relating to living things that are nothing like a human brain, and that doesn't tell us very much about what its cognitive capacities are and what we owe it in terms of ethics. Okay, so I think the future is, it has to deal with this incredible explosion of bodies and minds. So that's it. If you are interested in this stuff, here are some papers that go into all this in great detail. And I want to thank the people in my group who participated in producing all of the data that I showed you today. And I will thank our funders here. And I thank you for listening.
Thank you, Michael. That was really fascinating. We have a few minutes for questions.
So, Michael, you never disappoint us. you always expect our minds. So you are so far ahead of the regulatory agencies that, you know, you can do whatever experiments you want, but are you should be getting ahead of the science fiction writers now, because it isn't science fiction. I mean, there's a tremendous opportunity for you, because I know you're a great writer. I'm just giving you some friendly advice as a friend.
Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate it. I think in many ways, you're absolutely right. In many ways, the technology is way beyond the philosophy that has been written about this stuff, right? So there's all kinds of philosophy of mind that says, oh, what if, you know, what if we separate the two halves of the, you know, the two hemispheres? Is it one person or two? We are so far, not just us, but like the whole field is so far beyond all of that. It needs to catch up. Like, we need to develop conceptual apparatus in many directions to catch up to what the science is now.
Mike, fascinating as always.
Thank you, Tara. How are you doing?
Yeah, it's good, good. I was looking forward to your talk. And as Martha said, I was never disappointed. And you kind of throw us into this ocean of thoughts. And I don't know where to find the nearest island to land on. But let me ask you one very simple question. It seems to me from your experiment is that when you were showing the voltage map, when the voltage was coming from two ends, and it was greenish everywhere, but with some more intensity towards the two ends. And then comes the two eyes from both sides.
Yep.
And what struck me is that it seems like there is some tipping point where the resolution doesn't matter as long as a process gets started. So, you know, you're applying a voltage field, and this voltage field has far from precision from the image of the voltage die. But the eyes are precisely at a symmetric location on both sides. So does the biology wait for this tipping point without caring about all the precisions that we as engineers tend to think of? Like, yeah, to put the eye, I have to have a voltage field precisely given by this field map, rather than give me a field map, you know, just excite me, and I will come up with the precision that I have defined as a goal.
It's a great question. We've seen some of each. So, for example, in the case of the electric face, the positions of the bioelectric domains are quite specific about the size and the location of the organs. So the eye spot, that's where the eye is going to go. And if you move it, the eye will be somewhere else. So it's quite specific there. But other systems, when we grow a leg or a tail, we provide a kickstart that just basically says, start the leg growing module right here. And then we don't micromanage it. In fact, our latest, this paper hopefully will be out in a few weeks, we show that in an adult frog, you treat the wound for one day, 24 hours with a particular treatment, that gives rise to a year and a half of leg growth, at which point we never touch it at all, right? We stop our intervention at 24 hours. After that, so what we see generally is that there's an electrical circuit that makes decisions. And once it's made that decision, so this gets to your tipping point idea, once it's made the decision, everything is handed off to downstream molecular cascades. You start off with the WNTs and the BMPs and the, you know, MSX1 and all of these things. And all of that stuff runs, and we don't have to micromanage it, right? It's all, so you don't have to worry about it. However, there are other aspects. For example, once it starts making toes, there's another bioelectrical set of processes that say, well, how many toes are you gonna have? And if you wanted to intervene there, you could, I'm sure, we haven't done it, but I'm sure you could, and get a different number of toes. So there are different types of, like with any engineering system, there are different levels of modules. There are very high level modules, and there are down in the details, you know, sort of low level modules.
Yeah. Fascinating. I have to leave. I have a class to teach at 3:00. I'm already 5 minutes late. So bye, everybody.
Yeah, good to see you.
Bye.
Are there any?
I do have another question. I mean, anyone else who wants to talk can speak, please. interrupt, but since no one else is, and I'm watching for hands now, guys, especially the trainees, I read a report in the New York Times, my favorite journal, a couple of weeks ago about superweeds and the fact that if you treat the superweeds, oh, Samuel, do you want to ask a question before I finish?
No, you can go ahead and finish then.
Okay. They've put atrazine in, you know, they've genetically engineered it into soybeans. So those soybeans are resistant to the atrazine, but weeds are. But what's happened is that within 5 years after Monsanto developing it, the weeds are getting resistant. And that's faster than evolution. Everybody's like, how in the world are we going to keep ahead of the weeds if they can, you know, accommodate so fast? Yeah. And it's not looking like evolution, which made me think of your barium experiments.
Exactly.
And so I asked a very wise friend of mine who isn't on this call anymore. I won't name who it was, but I said, you know, what's going on? He said, well, most of these organisms have multiple genomes, and that's how they adapt to the changing environment. They go through the file cabinet when things change and they go, oh, that one will work. that doesn't sound like what you're thinking about, though.
No, because that's all well and good to have multiple genomes, but of course the big question is, how do you know for some weird new physiological stressor that you're experiencing which part of your genome? I mean, think about it. The organism has exactly the same problem that we workers in regenerative medicine have, which is, how do I know which genes to tweak to get a particular outcome? It's an incredibly difficult question because the mapping from genome to anatomy is not straightforward. And you can say in the barium, you could look at the barium experiment and say, oh, well, of course, they have genes for other ways to do things without potassium. Yeah, that's great, but they also have 30,000 other genes. And when you're a cell and you're blowing up, how do you know which genes are to write, right? I always visualize it like you're in a nuclear reactor control room, you know, there's buttons everywhere and the thing's melting down. You don't have time to start flipping buttons in some sort of like gradient descent. You'll be dead. There's no time for that. So how do you know? So I think what it's a long story, you know, I don't want to like you, we can talk about this offline, but it'll take a while. But I think what evolution has a really interesting architecture that it uses here, which we call multi-scale competency. And I think what it uses to solve all these kinds of problems much faster than standard evolutionary processes is the fact that every layer of organization knows a little bit something about its own competencies in some weird space. And so if you're a higher level that's called, if you're a kidney and you're calling for a kidney tubule, you may not know how to make a kidney tubule, especially if your cells are huge. You don't have any idea, but the cells down below know how to do certain things. And so this modularity, the same way that we can, I realize I'm being very, I'm talking in a rough way that, you know, you can get much more rigorous with this, but you don't, at every level, you don't need to know all the micro details of the lower level if you can trust your submodules to know that they know what they're doing in their little space, right? And that's the architecture that we have. We don't have a flat thing where everything has to call up, well, I know I want this gene and I want that gene. That's never going to work. That architecture is never going to work. What you have are modules which know how to call other smaller, stupider modules to get pieces of the problem solved. And that architecture is, I think, and so this is why, you know, we're trying to do this in for robotics now, right? Just to build this multi-scale architecture, because why don't we have general AI yet? For the exact same reason, because our robots are flat. I give a talk called Why Don't Robots Get Cancer? Why don't robots get cancer? Because their parts have no ability for independent activity, zero. And so, right? And so this is exactly the same. Biological architectures that are flat like that are not going to work.
That's my guess. Now, thank you. Now let's ask Samuel to give us his question.
Yeah, so my question is that when you kind of do this regeneration experiment, do you actually track the chemical profile of, like, in the course of the growth? So for instance, you've caused an amputation and a thing is trying to grow. Do you have a systematic way of trying to track the chemical profiles of what, so compared to a control, what are the chemical heterogeneity of the growing process? compared to a control organism that is actually, you have not caused any changes to, or you're not trying to regenerate any part of it? Yeah. Do you have any tracking sequence to actually know the heterogeneity between those counterparts?
Sure, and, We've done all that. So we know all the genes that are turned on, and we know the we've done the transcriptomics and the marker analysis and the the morphometrics and all of that. Sure, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, we even know the transduction machinery. We know how voltages turn on and off specific genes. We have all that because you need all that to publish all this stuff. You have to have all the details. Frankly, it's been singularly uninformative to answer the big questions that we actually have. So knowing how individual cells turn on specific genes from a specific voltage pattern in that cell has taught us, I'm going to say, almost nothing about how the global process works to give you a limb versus a tail versus an eye. It's a different problem. But yes, we have that information. It just, it's not sufficient for what we need to do.
Oh, okay. Nice. And another one that I had was that, I was thinking that when you have a building, for instance, and then you have the top of the building, then the basement supporting the top, you actually get a portion of the building off and you have to rebuild it. I mean, there is a certain engineering aspect you have to do in order to get the building back in shape, in order to reduce the pressure and to cause stability to actually happen. In the same sense, and using the same analogy, can you also attribute the fact that when you cause these voltage changes, you are actually causing a perturbation in the system where the system has to regenerate stability. And in the course of generating that stability, it goes through that cascade of pathways to build something to generate that kind of stability. So for instance, you have an amputated section of your hand. It can be that just getting that section amputated is causing some instability within your system. So therefore, it sends some pressure signals to some part of the framework. And then it has to regenerate that section in order to reach that stability. Or maybe you cause a perturbation by applying a voltage and you trigger an instability, which has to actually come back to the normal at set values and has to go through a process of generating something to achieve those goals, depending on the line that you call that perturbation.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. I mean, it's true in that a lot of these electrical circuits have specific instabilities, meaning there are states that are bifurcations where we've actually even made a line of unstable planaria that are random, where if you cut it, it randomly decides one head or two, right? So you can balance it right at that instability. So that every time you cut it, you get a random, one or two heads, so you can do that instability. Whether or not, how much mechanical instabilities play a role, that needs to be checked. We haven't done any biomechanics on this stuff. But the bioelectrics has its own instabilities.
Okay, thank you.
Well, as always, Michael.
Thank you so much.
I look forward to the next time.
Thanks very much. It's good to see you.
Good to see you.